Let's welcome our next speaker, Tobias, about, and this is talk. We've got 5 seconds, so 3, 2, 1, go.
So welcome everybody. I'm happy that so many people are interested in securing existing software, are not afraid of using phone verification. Let's start. I think it's not news for you that there is a long history of security vulnerabilities, and still today's software contains many security critical bugs. Here's a list of bugs which were found in communication protocols, and for this talk I selected one vulnerability in FIS on which I want to show you how existing software can be made more secure and how form verification can be used in this case. So FIS is a TLS 1.3 implementation created by Facebook. It is written in C++ and has a focus, of course, on security. So Facebook used modern C++ methods to ensure that common errors like buffer overflows does not happen. But nevertheless, a vulnerability was found. So an unauthenticated remote hacker was able to trigger an infinite loop in an application which uses this TLS library. This maybe doesn't sound this severe, but with little effort and little time, an attacker could be spawn many processes which are spinning in an infinite loop, and so you can keep in server with many cores in a short time, keep very busy. Let's have a look at a code which was attackable. So this is a part of a parsing function where a while loop was used. In this while loop, And a parsing function is called, which reads a 16-bit integer from a network packet. And this 16-bit integer is then stored in a variable called length. To this length later on, a static value is added. That's the size of the header. And after that, trim start is called on a buffer object, which tells the buffer how many bytes were consumed. What this does is actually we read how long this package is, and then skip over this package. After we have this done, then we continue at the start of the loop. What is the assumption here? The developer thinks, of course, the length must be bigger than zero. If this is not the case, no bytes are consumed, and so we get back to the beginning of the loop and have the same situation again. So we are stuck in infinite loop here. What does this mean for the value which we read from network packet? There we must have the assumption that the length must be less than 2 to the power of 16 minus 5, because the length of the static header is 5. That's a valid assumption if you look at valid TLS record packages, because there the length must be much lower than that. So the TLS standard says it should be below 2 to the power of 14 plus 256. But a remote attacker must not obey this rule. So it was just able to send a length which has this special value, 2 to the power of 16 plus 5, and then we add 5 to it, and so get an integer overflow, and the length is 0. And now we are stuck in infinite loop. So I would say the solution should be here that we check if the length is according to the standard. But Facebook selected another solution. They just use a bigger integer. So now we have no integer flow anymore, and so it works fine, even if the package is not standard conform. But how could we prevent such bugs? The usual answer is to keep a good software quality, so do code reviews, testing, fuzzing, and so on. But that all are measures which Facebook did, and they didn't find this bug. So we need some more enhanced techniques, like static code analysis. And so this bug was also found. A company called XAML, which is now acquired by GitHub, used a tool which is called CodeQL, which does a variant analysis. What the variant analysis does is it looks for patterns of known vulnerabilities and just searches for this pattern in the code. If there's a pattern, then we know that is this a known vulnerability. But there we have also the drawback of this. We can only look for patterns which are known to us. If there are any unknown vulnerabilities, we cannot find them. So I would favor a more constructive approach, and that would be form verification, where we can really prove while designing the code that there is no unexpected behavior in the program. Doing this on existing applications which mainly use C or C++, this is not really possible as it has too many features. You can do it maybe for a limited set, but not for all features which C or C++ give us. That's the reason that there are specially designed languages for formal verification, and Spark is one such language. Spark is a programming language which is based on Ada. It's like Ada, compilable with GCC and LVM, and is also very, very suited for embedded systems. So we have a customizable runtime, and you can customize it in a way that you have only really a minimal runtime, and then you can also use it on a system with very resource constraints. What Spark also offers is contracts, so you can add preconditions, postconditions, and invariants to your program, and so define with a high detail which behavior a subprogram should have. This is also the basis of the verification tools. They check when you use these functions if all contracts are fulfilled at any time. And they do this statically, so before really compiling the code or running it. What you can achieve with the verification tools is that you can prove absence of runtime errors, so there are no errors like buffer overflows, integer overflows, and similar things. Or you can even show functional correctness so that it really adheres to your specification of your program. Ada and Spark is mainly used in safety critical areas, but also in security. Let's have a practical look at Spark. Here I've re-implemented the attackable code part of this. It's really similar to that what we have seen before. We declare a length variable of an integer and then read some 16-bit value from an external source. Then we add 5 to the length, like what it was done before, and then we use this length variable later on. Spark is different to C++ in that we usually don't use integers which are built in, but we always define integer types with the certain properties which we need in this case. So there are two different types of integers. We can define modular integers, which behave like C++ or Z integers. So they just have a size and allow to overflow at any time. Or we can also use type range integers, where we can specify the range which is allowed for this integer, and where we also have the property that these integers are always not allowed to overflow. We also used such an integer type here for our length variable. And what we get when we now use the verification tools on this code example, will we see that the tools will tell us that a range check might fail in line 15. And they also tell us for which value of the length this integer overflow could happen. So we have really nice functionality with Spark to finding such errors. But the reality is so that currently usually software is written in unsafe languages like C and C++. Now we can think of using Spark instead of C and C++, but migrating existing software to these languages is very expensive, especially if we do it manually. But what could we do now? We could think of two options. Maybe you could only replace critical parts of the software. Usually, the most critical parts of software are the parts which interact with the outside world. So often these are the communication protocol implementations. And if you replace these parts with a verified implementation, we already enhance the security. Another option is to use code generation. So do not all implementation manually, but use a specification and generate code for it. This is what we have done with Record Flux. So Record Flux is a toolset which is developed by Componolead. This work is also supported by TU Dresden, and it comprises various things. One thing is that it has a specification language where it's possible to specify format of messages in a formal way. And this formal specification of messages can then be verified and checked if there are any inconsistencies in it. If there are no inconsistencies, we can then later on this, use the specification to generate parsers and message generators out of it. All code which is generated by Vector Flux is Spark code, and so we can check, or we can automatically prove that there are no runtime errors in the code. Another feature which Spark gives us is that we can statically ensure that only valid messages are accepted and that only valid messages can then also be processed. And in the same way, it is also ensured that we only can generate valid messages. The source code of Record Flux is available on GitHub. There you will also find some documentation. If you're interested more on the theoretical side of Record Flux, you can also have a look in our research paper. So now we have all building blocks to improve the security of existing application. We used as example FIS here, of course, and we replaced the existing parser by a verified parser, which we generated with Record Flux. Therefore, we had to create a specification of all messages which are specified in TS1.3, and then use the specification to generate the parser out of it. We have to remove the existing C++ parser of FIS and then integrate our verified parser into it. For all code which we have written and all code which we have generated with Record Flux, we are able to prove that there are no runtime errors in it. The code of this proof of concept can be also found on GitHub. Here you see an excerpt of the message specification. In particular, you see the specification of a TLS record message. Just to give you a high overview, what the specification does is on the left side, we specify some elementary types like enumerations and integers. And on the right side, you see the specification of a TLS record message where we specify the message format. Such a TLS record message is not that complicated. You have a tag, which is the content type. You have a version field. You have the length. And we have a payload field. What makes it a bit more complicated is that we here now differentiate if you have a plain text payload or an encrypted payload. When we now check the specification, we will see that there's an error in it, there's an inconsistency, as we have two conditions which check if the tag is not equal to application data. And as we have these in two branches, so in the two possibilities for encrypted and plain text payload, it's not clear for the parser which path it should take when it parses this message. So the residing parser would not be deterministic in this case. So we have to remove this inconsistency, and if we do that and check it again, we will see that the truth tells us now the specification is correct. And now we can also use the specification to generate code out of it. Now we have created the verified parser, and we have to think about how could we integrate this parser now into FIS. As Spark and C++ is not compatible with regard to the data structures which they use, we have to add some glue code in between. So here you see a Spark function which takes a buffer as input, so it's just a pointer to a binary, and which gives as result in a record which contains all information of the message which we have extracted. So a record in Spark is similar to a struct in C or C++. All functions or types which are highlighted in green here are functions which were generated by Record Flux. So what is done here? The first thing is that we declare a context. A context stores the internal state of our parser for this particular message. As next step, we initialize the result. So we set some default values which we want to have as in our result structure. And then we initialize our context. So in this initialization, we add a pointer to our context, and then this pointer is stored inside the context, and we can do the things which we want to do during parsing. So the actual parsing is then done by calling verify message. What verify message does is that it checks field by field if this field is valid, so that all conditions which we have specified in our specifications are fulfilled. and then the result is stored in the context. And later on, we have different functions which we can use to use this information in the context. So what is done here is we check if the length field is valid. If this is the case, we are allowed to also access the value, which is done, for example, here with the getLength function. The nice thing of using Spark in this case is that we can prove that the parser is used correctly. So if you would forget to check that the length field is valid, but just try to access the value in the length field, then we would see in our Spark tools that the precondition of the getLength function is not fulfilled, as we did not check valid before. And so we really see if the parser is used correctly, and we do not anything which is not supported, or which could lead to some error at the end. We need an additional layer to integrate the parser interface. We, as I already told, this Spark data structures and C++ data structures are not compatible, but Spark offers a foreign function interface, so we can specify in record and say that it should have a convention C, and so it has the same binary layout as in struct. So you see an example here for our record, and on the left side and on the right side is C struct. And the same is also done for functions. So we have here the parse record message, where we also define it should we have convention C, and we also define the name, and on the right side you see the C counterpart. The next thing is then that we have to integrate the parser into the actual FIS code. Therefore, we have also to think about the buffer object. So as I already told in the beginning, FIS or Facebook used for implementing FIS some data structures which prevent buffer overflows. And this buffer object also offers other features like scatter getter. And so we need to convert this structure into something which we can use on the Spark side. Actually, what we need is one pointer to a byte array, but what we have here is a list of pointers to various buffers. So what is done here in the first lines is that we allocate enough space and then copy all buffers into one contiguous buffer and then take a C pointer out of it. This C pointer can then be used for our parse function. We also have to allocate some memory for the result, and then we are able to call the parse record message function. Then you see we have removed some code. This red lines is the code which you have seen before. So this is the actual parser which was used for reading the length. And we now can just use the result which we got from our parse function, and we added in this case. So this, you see the starts functions that we just add to the plaintext header size, the record length, and this is now secure because we check if the length is according to the standard, and in the standard, the value of the length field is much below than a 16-bit integer where we have the overflow before. But what I forgot here, we also added in between and check if the record which we got from our parsing function is correct. So there we see, we check if it's a valid ciphertext because we expect here a TLS record with ciphertext in the payload. And if it's not a valid TLS record message, then we throw an exception and terminate the TLS connection in this case. We also looked at the performance which we got from our modified FIS. Therefore, we created a small HTTP server which just returns a static page. And this static HTTP server then used FIS for the TLS connections. On the client side, we used WRK, which sends a continuous stream of HTTP requests, and we measures the latency and the throughput. We measured the handshake layer and the record layer separately. For the handshake layer, we just opened a TLS handshake for each HTTP request, and on the record layer, we only opened one TLS handshake and then sent a continuous stream of HTTP requests over this TLS connection. What we saw is that this impact is really small, so it's around 1% to 3%. And we also analyzed where this performance impact came from, and saw that it's not a verified parser which we generate, but it's mainly the conversions functions to convert the data structure of C++ to Spark. We only have seen a really simple TLS record message, but there are more complicated TLS messages, of course, where you have sequences of messages, which again can have sequences into it. And these are represented in FIS with C++ vectors and objects, and they, of course, are not compatible to Spark. So we need to do some conversion, and that uses some performance at the end. So now we have seen it's possible to secure an existing application with a formally verified library, but we want to even go one step further in the future. We are currently working on Green TLS, which is a component-based higher assurance implementation of TLS 1.3, where we want to implement all critical components in Spark. And all these critical components should be also specified with the specification language of Record Flux and then generated out of it. The current state is that we work mainly on Record Flux because it's the main building block. We specified all messages of TLS 1.3, and we are currently working on designing the architecture and the protocol specification. The implementation of Green TLS will be also available as open source on GitHub. Coming to a conclusion, what we did is creating a formally verified library, in this case a parser for TLS 1.3. We integrated this verified library into an existing software, FIS, and we have seen that there are some obstacles. So we saw that it's cumbersome to convert these Spark and C++ data structures, but it is possible at the end. And we have also seen, without doing any optimization, that the performance impact is really small. So you can conclude that it's really possible to use formal verification to secure an existing software. That's it. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to help.